Good evening. Hi there, everybody. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library, and we'll just wait one moment as folks come into our digital room. We're looking forward to tonight's conversation with Alex Graham and Phoebe Gloeckner, and we are having a few technical difficulties with the weather in Michigan. So we're hoping that the internet will stay stable enough for Phoebe to be able to join us tonight. So we're working on the weather. It looks like folks are still coming into our digital room, so we'll just wait one more second as we get started. And great, it looks like our numbers have stabilized, so we'll go ahead and get started. Good evening. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders, past and present, and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to tonight's program, which is presented in partnership with Elliott Bay Book Company and Fantagraphics Books. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. Our friends over at Elliott Bay have copies of Alex's book. You can find books at their website, elliottbaybook.com, and we'll be dropping direct links to Alex's books in the chat throughout the course of the evening. I wanted to mention that we have closed captioning available tonight as well. To access the closed captioning, you just click on the closed caption icon at the bottom of your screen. I think it says live transcript on mine as well, so that's what that means. And after tonight's conversation, we'll have time for questions from you. You can ask your question at any time by writing it in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And finally, we're interested in hearing from you. Toward the close of the event, we'll be posting a link to a survey in the chat and would appreciate it if you took a minute to fill it out after the program. Now, I'm delighted to introduce tonight's speakers. Alex Graham is a painter and cartoonist from Seattle. She's the author of the pandemic-inspired graphic novel, Dog Biscuits, which she serialized on Instagram and later self-published. Dog Biscuits is now being released by Fantagraphics, and we're celebrating the release tonight. Alex is currently serializing her new graphic novel, The Devil's Grin, on Substack. She'll talk tonight with Phoebe Gloeckner. Phoebe is a cartoonist, writer, trained medical illustrator, and a professor at the University of Michigan School of Art and Design. Her best-known works are the comics collection A Child's Life and Other Stories, and the genre-defying illustrated novel Diary of a Teenage Girl, An Account in Words and Pictures. Gloeckner is also known for her illustrations of J.G. Ballard's reissue of The Atrocity Exhibition and for her covers to the classic books Angry Women and Angry Women in Rock. Please help me welcome Alex and Phoebe. And Alex and Phoebe, you can now unhide your video. That's perfect. And I'm going to spotlight you. Oh, I lost you, Phoebe, though, when I did that. Come back. This is what happens. I lost you,
Can you hear
Alex.
me?
There we go. Now we got everybody here. Okay, now I'm going to go and the two of you can be brilliant and chat. Thank
Okay.
you.
Thank you, Stesha. Alex,
Hi, Phoebe.
hi, long time no see.
Yeah, it's been about
5 months, something like that.
4 or 5 months, right? And never in person. Okay, if I cut out, will someone wave at me, because I might not know?
Yeah, I'll start waving.
Okay, good.
Yes.
Yeah. So, Alex, I love your book.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's funny because when I first started reading it, I could almost imagine you going through the process of like, you know, one panel a day or one page a day, mm-hmm. and then posting it to Instagram. But right. as it went on, it became so not what I imagined it would be in the end. It became so complex, and it seemed like, to me,
cutting out. I didn't hear anything after "to me."
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Okay. So why don't you describe the process of making this book, first of all, before I say anything?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So I was still working in restaurants, a restaurant, in fact, at the time that I started drawing this comic. It was June of 2020 when the pandemic first started, and the restaurants were still open at first, and then, but like the restaurant that I worked at, we got a PPP loan from the government, and every employee had to be at the restaurant for 40 hours a week according to the PPP loan standards. So me and all my coworkers were there doing nothing. Like every maybe hour and a half a customer would come in, but nobody was going to restaurants at that time. So me and all my coworkers were just sitting around twiddling our thumbs, watching TV, scrolling. I was scrolling, but I was reading books too. And I read a book by Camus. What was it? It was The Fall. I read The Fall by Camus. And then after that, I read Factotum by Bukowski, Charles Bukowski. And while I was reading Factotum by Charles Bukowski, at one point I got tired of reading it. And on that very page, when I got tired of reading it, there was a paragraph that said that the main character started working at a dog biscuits factory. And when I stopped on that paragraph, I decided to get up and go to the office of the restaurant and grab some printer paper and decided to start drawing a comic. And the inspiration for this was I had seen Benjamin Mara and I had seen Simon Hanselman both posting swipe comics on Instagram. And I wanted to do the same thing, but I hadn't done any art for about a month and a half because of all the political shit that was going on in the world at the time. I just didn't feel like my voice mattered. But at that moment, I decided that like I had nothing better to do at work besides draw something and make a comic. So yeah, that's what I did. I went to the office and I grabbed some printer paper and I drew 6 squares on a piece of paper. And the very first panel that I drew was a dog biscuits bakery. And I had no idea what was going to happen after that from panel to panel. And that's exactly how it was from the first page to about the maybe 70th page. I had no idea what was going to happen from panel to panel. So if you read the book, you can maybe sense that like there was no like structure from panel to panel, forethought on what was going to happen. But I actually did redraw the first 20 pages or so too. So
that's really interesting. So you say Then what happened around page 70? Did you then start thinking in advance and trying to structure something?
That was when I got laid off again from work, and I ended up back at home, and I had more time to think about what was going to happen in the story. Like, the story became my entire life, because we were all stuck at home, and some people were baking bread or whatever, and but this dog biscuits became my entire life. I had so much time to think about what was going to happen in this story from moment to moment, and the plot would just come to me. Eventually the whole plot came to me. The ending is the most important part that can occur to an author, and I'm lucky that the last few stories that I've come up with, the ending has occurred to me before I arrived there. Way before I arrived there, so I just have to fill in from here to here. I have to fill in this spot, because I have this part and I have this part. So yeah.
It's just like emotionally and complex, and the characters. I mean, I could say a lot about the characters, knowing you as much as I do, which is not that much, but enough perhaps.
A little bit.
It almost seems like these three main characters, Rosie, Gussie, and Hissy,
the last thing I heard was Hissy.
Oh, damn. Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear me now.
Okay, it says my internet connection is unstable. I'm telling you, we're having a weird heat wave. I don't know what it's
doing.
Okay, what I was trying to say is that...
the last thing I heard was, is that...
Rosie. And, okay. I want to say that these three characters, as far as I know you, which is not that much, it almost seems like there are parts of you in each of these characters.
Yes, that's correct. I would say that each of these characters is a facet of myself. I've realized that Rosie is who I was when I was in my early 20s. And Gussie is who I am now, a little bit older and a little bit more bitter, a little bit more disenchanted with life. And Hissy is me and my arrogance and my hubris that, you know, are a continuation through my life that I have to...
Right, still persist, yeah.
Yes, exactly. They're all aspects of myself, but parts of them are based on other people that I've known too, but not strictly.
Sure, but the thing is that's so interesting.
The last thing I heard was interesting.
Sense that you have such empathy for these characters. Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Okay, well, my sense is that you have such empathy, you as the author, for these characters, particularly Gussie and Rosie. And you all... to each get really philosophical at point, Dalsky, but... many characters, the primary characters, and then even such characters as, what's his name, Sklur?
Sklur.
Right, they start going into these long rants or you know, explorations about...
Mm-hmm.
And pretty other times they're just depressed and they just go off on these tangents, which seem really deep and really interesting. But all characters have an opportunity to do that, except for what's her name? Danny.
Yeah. yeah. Danny is kind of a one-dimensional character. But yeah, when I was in my sorry if I'm talking over you. I can't tell if you're
done.
Yeah. Okay. But when I was in my teens and early 20s and stuff like that, I read a lot of philosophy, and I always wanted to be a writer more than an artist. I always wanted to be a novelist more than a visual artist. And a lot of my favorite novelists would philosophize a lot through their characters. And I read a lot of philosophy when I was in my early 20s. And I don't know, I just feel like that's a fulfilling way to approach writing, is to insert some philosophy wherever you can. I don't know, that's kind of writing I like to read.
Yeah, I mean, I think it both educates the audience and kind of shines a light on those characters.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so mm-hmm. No, it's really interesting and really smart.
Yeah.
And also, I mean, you really...
Back up a little bit, I didn't hear that. Maybe it'll just lag.
The story of these people's internal struggles? Okay. Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Yes.
Okay. You... I froze. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Could you hear anything?
I didn't hear anything you said.
Okay. You can't hear me now, can you? No.
I can hear you right now. Right now I can hear you. Stupid internet. Poor Phoebe. I'm sorry. I'm sorry you're going through this.
Can you hear me better? Maybe this is better now. Okay.
Yes.
Let's hope. Okay. What I was saying is that you really show us the internal struggles of these characters really beautifully. Am I gone?
I can hear you very well now. I can hear you very well. So this is great.
Oh. Like on page 270, I write these pages. No one has the book in front of them, I'm sure. But like when Rosie says, she's lying in bed, I think, and she says, I always need more, more, more.
Yeah.
I'm never present, never content, never satisfied. I don't deserve.
Right.
Insights into these personalities, it feels so real.
Yeah, I would say that the reason that they feel so real, in regard to this specific book, I don't know if it'll apply to future books that I make, but it's because that I admit that at the time when I was writing Dog Biscuits, I was using it as a form of diary, because I was tackling things that were happening in the day that they were happening, personally and globally, regarding the news, and processing things through the book. I don't know if I will approach future books that way, but it just seemed correct to do that with Dog Biscuits, because there was every day when you woke up during the pandemic in 2020, something new would happen, and we were just all processing it together, and I was processing it through the lens of you know, society and through the lens of myself. And so that's how I would structure the story and the dialogue, and also I would utilize the thought bubbles a lot in Dog Biscuits to, it's hard to admit that some of those thoughts were my thoughts, because that's very intimate, but some of those thoughts were my thoughts. Some of them were.
And why
not.
Shouldn't you use them?
What's that?
Right. Which is perfectly valid. I mean, I think all writers do that.
Right.
To a large extent. And not sneak in an occasional critique of it.
I didn't catch the first part of that question.
Okay. God, this is so frustrating.
I know. I'm so sorry, Phoebe. Thank you for doing this.
I wanted to say that, and remember to wave your hand. Do you know where there's a good internet connection? I don't know where to go.
I don't know. Can you like type the questions in the chat or something? And I can answer them there. Pull up the chat here.
Well, while Phoebe is getting her internet sorted out, Alex, do you want to maybe talk a little
okay,
bit
if
more?
You can, I'm going to...
Oh, go ahead, Phoebe. Okay, I think she's going to work on that. So,
okay.
So what you were just saying about admitting that some of those thoughts were your thoughts,
mm-hmm.
And that's uncomfortable because vulnerable because you
right.
know it's so intimate, but you know you created the book, so aren't all of the thoughts your thoughts?
Right,
sort of. Yeah. But
some of them are more, a little bit more removed from exactly what I was feeling that day. More like what would that like takes several more steps out of me. Like, what would this character be feeling this day, rather than like, what exactly am I feeling right at this moment, right now? I'm not going to tell you which thought bubbles are mine.
Yeah.
Whereas like, some of them are a few steps removed from me. Well, I mean, all of them are my thoughts, obviously, I think.
Or your thoughts about what people might think.
Maybe from a higher power. I feel like I truly believe that some of what comes out of me artistically is from like a higher power, but some of them are intimately me. Unfortunately, those are probably the lesser ones.
No. Hi again, Phoebe. How's it going?
Hi, Phoebe.
Hi. I'm in the basement now. Maybe this works better.
This is our third venue for people that are tracking.
That's right. I was trying to make the point earlier that you mentioned that you were, you know, responding to current events all through this time,
right.
Which I think everybody was, and probably to a certain extent still is. But so you reflect those things, and you even at times sneak in a little critique of those things, like Hissy is like, you know, moaning about how language is actually oppressing us and not
right.
Yeah.
Yes.
You want to talk about that? Yeah.
I would love to talk about that. That's a great question. I feel like language is kind of a surface experience as far as all the experience that we can have as a human being. Language is kind of a surface experience. And as far as that goes, at the time that I was writing Dog Biscuits, changed a little bit since then. But that I feel like at the time that I was writing Dog Biscuits, we were leaning so hard into words and how they define things that it robbed us of some nuance of being, being a human being. I feel like we've kind of gotten away from that a little bit since I wrote the story. I think we're a little bit better about that now.
Yeah, I think so too. Thank God. Yeah, because it contributed to the polarization of thought. And
Exactly. Yeah. When you put so much pressure on a word, a single word, that's why I do visual art, because I want to escape from language sometimes, you know?
Right.
Like, language is so minimizing it, and it's so, what do you say?
Like, it's so imprecise.
Limiting. Yeah. And when you call yourself a word, you're just limiting yourself to that word.
Right. And when people are canceled or criticized for not using the right word, mm-hmm. intentionally or not, it just really, you know.
Exactly.
There's no way to return from that. It's like, you know, I don't know. But wait, I had some other things I was going to say. You also have some wonderful dream sequences in this book.
Oh yeah. Okay. So the dream sequence, there is a dream sequence in the book where Gussie is thrown off a plank into an alligator pit.
Wait, wasn't that a firefighter's practice tower?
Yeah, that's pretty much what it was. And there's an alligator pit at the bottom. I had that dream the night before I drew that page.
Really?
Yes.
It was very powerful in that place in the book. It was just kind of frightening. I mean, and it's funny because this book, I mean, I use the word frightening, and it was frightening. And the book is also heartbreaking, but it has so much humor in it that, you know, kind of carries it along. I mean, at times the characters become almost like stereotypes of a certain sort of person, but then you're able to kind of use that and go much deeper.
Right. And
yeah. So it's really fantastic. And it's also, I mean, I don't want to give the book away, so I won't, but it's just like this push and pull of relationships of people who maybe should be together, but there's all of this like internal stuff that they're fighting that prevents them from actually connecting. And
right.
It's like we have force fields around us. We want to have love. We want to love, but we just can't break through that kind of force field around ourselves. And it's sad because, well, I can't talk about how it's sad because that would give away the ending. So I won't.
Yeah. Well, the way I prefer to tell stories myself is to be realistic. I don't think I'll ever have a happy ending in any story that I tell, because that's not how life is. And the absurdism that I utilize in my stories is actually because I believe in using realism in my stories, because life is absurd. So when you see me using absurdism, it's not because I'm trying to get away from reality, it's because I'm trying to get more in touch with reality. And when I end a story on maybe a sad note, it's because I want to evoke feelings that people might have felt in places in their life. Because nothing in life really ends on a happy note. It continues, it always continues, and there's sadness, and there's failure, and maybe there's definitely happy times too,
right?
But nothing ever ends on a happy note,
right? We all die in the end, and so does everyone else around us. I mean, but the thing is, there are happy moments, right? Like,
absolutely.
You get your book published, it's a happy moment. I mean, you could end a book on a happy moment. You could.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because even in this book, there's plenty of happy moments, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
And but you didn't end at that happy moment, right?
Right.
So you're choosing that. It's not just that life ends unhappily. It's just where we decide to see the beginning and the end of an experience or even of a life, which and that's constantly kind of moving. So
it's always forward moving. It's always up and down until the day that you die. The only time a story ends is when somebody dies.
And even then it doesn't, because the people who knew you well will think about you and linger.
Yeah.
What's the saying? You're only dead when the last person who knew you is dead.
Yeah, that's a crazy thought.
Because
for some people, like Napoleon is still being talked about to this day, and he died however many years ago, but there are people that died yesterday that will never be talked about again, you know? Yeah.
Eleanor Rigby.
Yes.
Okay, so I just want to say, the moment I thought to myself, gee, these characters are parts of Alex. It's when Gussie returned to his painting, or dragged out that painting that he did.
Yeah.
Okay? Because he hadn't painted in years. He kind of gave up on it. I guess he didn't see enough success, but then he pulled out this painting and I thought, that's Alex's painting.
it was literally my painting. Yeah.
Yeah. And I don't know if your audience knows that you really are a prolific painter. And it's also amazing to see the trajectory of that aspect of your career. I remember, in high school, didn't you get all sorts of awards? I mean, you did these like kind of beautifully realistic, kind of surreal, I guess that's the word.
Yeah.
But the style in a sense was very different.
Right.
But nevertheless, I mean, they're like highly skilled pieces of work. And I don't know if people know that about Alex, but, and you've done not only painting, but you've worked in three-dimensional media, like doing those clay covers for some of your comic books.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
And animation, just trying everything. Mm-hmm. So you really explore, you mm-hmm. know. So it will be interesting to see, you know, I'm always curious to see if any of that other work will eventually kind of meld with your comics work or you know, get in there and kind of transform it in some way, because right. that all of that is in you. So I'm
I would say my first love of arts was truly telling stories. I've always, since I was a little kid, I've always just wanted to tell stories, and everything else came secondary to that. So my clay work, my painting, my drawing all came secondary to telling stories. So even my paintings that are just a singular image that don't continue anywhere, to me, that's a whole story there. And when I was 20, 21 years old, I wrote a 100,000 word novel.
How many pages is that? How long is that?
That's, it was like, I aimed for that many words because it was like the standard size of a novel, so maybe like 300 pages or something. But I wrote an entire novel when I was 21 years old, and nobody would read it.
How dare they?
I thought that as soon as I finished writing this novel that I would have my career set. I would never have to work again. And I would be on like the New York Times bestseller list and everything, but there are a couple people who did read it graciously, but it wasn't very good. Now that I look back on it, it wasn't very good. And I understand why nobody read it, but that to me was the amount of effort that I needed to make back then to understand that I needed to explore my life, I needed to grow, and also try making comics instead, like try telling stories with comics instead, because if there's a picture, if there's an image with it, I can fulfill myself by telling stories, but also I can use my art skills too. And also it's easier to get people to look at it because there's an image there. So I think that was the very first thing I did that started me on this path towards being a comic artist. But also a very important thing was that in my mid-20s, I started reading Weirdo magazine, which had you in it, and Robert Crumb, and all those people, and I started collecting those and reading those, and those were such an inspiration to me that I knew that when I started reading those, that's exactly what I'd wanted to do. And it took me about 5 years to figure out my style, but I think I finally figured it out.
Have you? I mean, you don't see style as something that constantly changes over a lifetime?
Oh, yeah. It's going to keep... No. I don't think I've settled on a style. I think I have figured out something that works for now, but definitely I could keep growing and changing. Absolutely.
So speaking of influences, it seems like your friend Simon Hanselman is one of your main influences. And I know he's like super prolific, right? He, they.
I think he's so good by him.
And it almost seems like you were inspired by Simon to like produce this, like to keep going, push yourself to do more, 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 more.
Oh yeah. When I first saw Simon's comics, mm-hmm. I don't know if you're familiar with Noah Van Sciver.
Yeah.
Okay. I was hanging out with Noah Van Sciver. He was my neighbor in Denver, and we went to Barnes & Noble together, and he pulled out Mega Hex from the bookshelf, and I had never seen it before. And he's like, "Have you ever seen this?" And I was like, "No." And I flipped through it, and I was like, "Oh my god, this is the coolest shit I've ever seen in my life." And I flipped to the back, and I saw that Simon Hanselman was in drag, and I was like, "Holy shit, this is changing my life right now." And from that moment, I like just saw, like, between the Weirdo comics and seeing Mega Hex, I just had like an epiphany. Mm-hmm. And from that moment, I knew exactly what I wanted to do.
That's great. I mean, this is probably not related to Simon Hanselman, but I really liked it in the book. You have this little cameo of an owl.
Oh yeah, that's the what is that sucker that the owl, 1, 2, 3, the sucker that the owl, the old commercials, what's it called?
Tootsie Pops. Oh my god, Bill Cardalopoulos.
Yes. Okay, that's what that is.
Okay, that's what that is. Okay.
Yeah.
But it's great because it kind of breaks, it interrupts the reading, and then you suddenly get someone else's point of view and commentary. Mm-hmm. it was just, you know, very brief, four frames, but it really enlivened the book and got thinking about this kind of self-reflexive thing about, you know, who is the artist, who is the reader, who is this other person reading the book, and why are they in the book, you know.
That page almost didn't happen. It was a matter of, I finished the page before it and I went to go lay down. And as I was laying down, looking at the ceiling, not thinking of the comic, that just occurred to me out of nowhere. And I got up and I sketched it out again. And then I drew it the next day. Like, that wouldn't have happened if I had decided to go to the bar that night or something, or like do anything else instead, you know. But it's just a matter of like exactly how things occurred in that very night and then that very moment that it happened.
No, but it's great. It really enlivens the reading. And I love how you incorporated like your dream, as you said, of the guy falling into the alligator pit. Because these things all fit in with the narrative really well, but they feel really fresh and they're kind of startling at times.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Let's see. What was I gonna say? And anyway, I think, hang on, I'm looking at my notes. Please excuse me.
No problem. Take your time. I'm just glad you're coming in clear now.
Oh yeah.
Nice and clear.
Yeah, I guess I have to live in the basement now. I don't know. Stasha mentioned your next book that you already have in progress. Is that true?
Oh yeah. I'm gonna print this book in floppies as it goes, probably around 50 pages each floppy. I've finished the first part. It's the working title is Devil's Grin. I don't know if I'm gonna keep it that for the print, for the collected edition, but for the floppies, it's gonna be called The Devil's Grin. And I finished the prologue that was around 50 pages and I printed it and I sold it last month. I sent them all out. Now I'm on the first part. To me, the story is just now starting. The prologue, people may be wondering why some of my signature themes are missing, but I had to lay out the story, okay? And I'm really excited about this. I think I'm gonna try and make a better story than I ever have, but maybe I'm shooting myself in the foot by trying. I don't know, who knows?
Yeah, there's something, I'm always afraid I'm going to jinx myself when I try to do something good.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Right. Does this book, The Devil's Grin, does it have any of the same characters or is it totally?
No, it's totally different. The first part happens in 1948. That's the prologue that I already sent out, but that's over. The next, the full story happens in 1974. Okay. And I was thinking about maybe utilizing some of my Dog Biscuits characters in there, but so far none of them have made it in.
Okay. But if it seems like they need to appear, they will, I guess.
Exactly. Who knows?
Right.
They might appear.
Okay, so it sounds like I have a copy of Dog Biscuits, but, and I love the cover, by the way. If you guys can't see it, it's the proprietor of the Dog Biscuit shop, and he looks like he's got a tray of dog biscuits made in the shapes of the characters, and they're kind of burning. They're all singed.
Yeah.
But this is self-published, this one, right? That I got. You sent this to me, right?
It's the Fantagraphics edition right here, and you can see it.
Okay, and then Fantagraphics. Right, okay.
Old and
so it's a different cover. Okay, so what happened? I mean, so are you going the same route this time? Did you self-publish the floppies or did Fantagraphics do that?
I'm self-publishing the floppies all throughout. I'm not going to make any assumptions about who wants to publish this. Right. So I'm self-publishing it all throughout the floppies, and then maybe if it's good enough at the end, maybe somebody will want to publish it. I don't know.
Of course they will.
I don't want to make any assumptions, but.
Yeah, but no, but this book, Dog Biscuits, has gotten a lot of attention. I mean, didn't you just come back from Spain a while ago? And
oh, yeah. Yeah, I went to Spain to receive my Pucci Award for Dog Biscuits that I received. And they translated Dog Biscuits into Spanish. And I don't know if I'm supposed to say this, but Dog Biscuits is going to also be published to French, but that was just very recent. And that was awesome.
That's fantastic. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, I'm
so I've never glad. Been out of the country before, so it's crazy that the amount of people that say that comics can't do anything for your career, like the comics that I've made have taken me outside of the country for the very first time in my life, so.
Which is really fucking amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I remember the first time I went out of the country, it was like going to Mars. You know, it's like,
yeah,
everything was so different.
Yeah, I remember last time I talked to you before I left, you said that even the signs and like the doorknobs and stuff like that would be strange. And it's true, because like even like the street signs and like the stuff like that, like even the things we take for granted here are so amazing. Like, it's so beautiful.
Yeah, it is. I mean, yeah, there's nothing that'll shake up your world than, you know, seeing things that are slightly different. You feel like you're, you know, it really wakes you up. Like,
right.
We're not all America, and we're not all even trying to be.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. Well, is there, were we supposed to leave time now for the audience? I think that I don't want to get off track. Is Stesha, were we supposed to like see if there were, yes. Are there questions?
There are questions, and I am happy to pose them to you if you like. And I want to thank you both for a wonderful conversation. And thank you, Phoebe, for persevering with the internet issues, and for everybody bearing with us all as we got that sorted out. And we do have some questions in the Q&A here for you. And so let's see. Piero asks, thank you for your work, Alex. Do you have any hindsight observations about how the Instagram comments section and their predictions and commentary may mm-hmm. have or have not affected decisions on where to take the story?
Oh, yes. There were, you know what? I'm ready to admit that the comments did have an effect on the story. And that's why with my current story, I'm doing a 30-page delay so that it does not affect my story at all. But anyway, there were comments that filled my heart with joy and made me so happy and made me feel so fulfilled as an artist and made me feel like I was making a difference in the world. And then there were comments that... hurt my feelings because I was writing from the heart and I was writing these characters as aspects of myself. And there were people that were occasionally wishing death on these characters for the private thoughts they were having. And just some really silly things. I'm not gonna say like every silly thing hurt my feelings, like some of it made me laugh, but there was one time that I cried because somebody hurt my feelings, so only one time though, okay. One time. But I mean, honestly though, publishing for a live audience is super it's like thrilling. It's the closest I'm ever going to get to being on stage and performing in front of a live audience, which
are you doing it right now?
Yeah, this yeah. But like with the like material that I'm ready to come out with, but like, you know, I daydream about being a performer, and that's never gonna happen. I'm not a performer, so the Instagram is the closest thing that I'm ever gonna do to it. But now I do it with a buffer, so it can't hurt my feelings as much if people say anything. And but I will say that some of the things that people were saying did affect Dog Biscuits and how it ran. Sometimes I would do things purposely to piss off somebody that said something. And it's been so long now that I can't exactly say what it was anymore. I don't remember. But yeah, if you read it, you can know that I made certain decisions to piss people off based on what they were saying.
And now it's a part of the work forever.
Yes, it's permanent.
We have a question here from Claire that's actually for both of you. It says, this is a question for both Alex and Phoebe. Do you feel that you are more visual learners of our world, you both graphic artists, than seeing the written word?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I feel like I get like dyslexic or numeralexic when I read. I definitely have to see things. To like when I'm putting together a piece of furniture, I have to see the image mm-hmm. to be able to put it together.
Mm-hmm. I guess I'm confused by the question. You're talking about learning something, right?
I think so. I mean, I think you can answer it however you take the question, but yeah, I think that was the part of it.
Yeah, well, yeah, I definitely learn better with pictures and words. But as Alex said earlier, I mean, she likes to write. She thought of herself primarily as a writer. And I think I always have too. I've always written a lot, but it always seemed incomplete without pictures. I had to add pictures. So, and it doesn't necessarily mean comics. I would do like long stretches of text and then it would still have to have pictures, you know?
Yeah. Just,
yeah.
Do either of you think in images rather than phrases or words? Yeah.
Absolutely. I can see when I'm falling asleep at night, I see full cartoons happening right in front of me. As soon as my consciousness turns to dreaming, I just see full cartoons happening in front of my eyes, like Looney Tunes.
Whoa. Yeah. Yeah, no, I definitely see things. You know, I retrace things that I did that day, whether it's a drawing or I built something or did something. It's like I go through the whole thing again and then I see it in three mm-hmm. dimensions. Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, that's very cool. As a very verbal oriented, literary oriented person, like I'm very I have a hard time visualizing things sometimes, so I'm envious of you both. We have just a comment back from Piero saying, thank you so much for your answer. It was a powerful experience during a very crazy time. I was glued to my feed waiting for the next post. So clearly Piero was not the person you were trying to piss off. So
yeah,
or maybe, and he just liked it, but
right.
We have a longish question from Star. So I'm going to try and capture the essence here if I can, although it's in three parts here. So so let's see. Star says, I grew up being influenced mostly Japanese productions, both general and more subcultural. I had a big cultural shift after moving to the US and got to choose to enroll in women's comics classes during college. While reading the given assignments, including Professor Phoebe's book, I not only found that there was not only a difference in narratives, like Ghost in the Shell versus A Child's Life, I felt as if there could be a big gap I'm not understanding this, but with what's intimately and evocatively told and what's taught as the standard. I think comparing, for example, a Shakespearean plot to Marvel movies. So such specific qualities made me look into more underground artists, including Robert Crumb, and made me think that there could be more people who have similar thoughts with me, especially in experimental genres. So that's how I understand Phoebe's work, since I think it's kind of disrespectful to interpret her works as needing to be labeled under trauma or another medical term. So on that regard, I'm interested in knowing how both Alex and Phoebe might think about such differences among readers' experiences and how their preferences or experience might influence their choice of purchase among graphic novels that may concern topics regarding trauma at depth or not. I hope this was a comprehensible question. And if I'm not doing a good job, Star, chime in the chat or in the Q&A and see if I'm not capturing the essence there of what you were asking. But I think what Star is asking is, you know, sort of exploring that there's this difference in narratives, and then, but there's a gap in what maybe more experimental comics do, and then what sort of more mainstream comics do, I think is maybe where the question's going. Star says, no, that was great. So hopefully, oh wait, we got one more clarification here. Yeah, because there's always violence. So do either of you have thoughts about sort of maybe differences between mainstream and more experimental comics or?
Well, I'll just quickly say, I had, because Star said something about my work being classified as like the literature of trauma or something. And I think I can't remember the exact question, but she was saying, was it right to do that? You know, and no, I hate it when it's categorized like that, because it's just about a life. I mean, we all have trauma, different types of trauma. And so I really do kind of hate all labels, period. Mm-hmm. True, I think I'm saying all, but, and okay, so that's all, my only thought that was just directed at that, okay.
Alex, but, any?
Yeah, I think I pretty much feel the same way as Phoebe, that like, I wouldn't look at my work and think anything about trauma. I would think about the things that happen in everybody's life, regardless of gender or race or anything like that. Like, we all encounter moments where shit sucks, you know? And like, a lot of media maybe doesn't address that, because a lot of media wants you to think that there's a life that you're living that you're not living, and you're the one missing out. But we all encounter shit that sucks, man.
Right. Like, and and also media wants you to think that there's a way that you can get over everything, anything. That
right.
They're prescribed, you know, you just call, you know, get a therapist on betterhelp.com. They'll specialize in
everything. Right.
Or read this book or read that. And, you know, there's no cure for living.
Exactly. I agree with that. Like, just, I feel like the most honest artwork is going to be a little gritty. It's going to be a little uncomfortable. It's going to be a little gross. It's going to be a little violent.
And it's going to be a little beautiful.
Exactly. That's exactly the entire cusp of what art should be. Not just happy, not just funny, not just gentle. That's dishonest art.
I think that that is kind of a lovely place to end in terms of what we are asking for from our art, and that it is going to be that blend of all of those things. I think that that is beautiful. I wanted to share one last comment from Ray. Alex, I'm so happy to see your book being published by Fanta. I don't have any good questions, just support. So it's a nice
Thank
comment.
You, Ray.
Yeah. Well, I'm so appreciative to you both, and thanks to everybody for persevering. Oh, I'm seeing a couple more questions here. Let's see. We do need to wrap up, but maybe we have time for one more question. It looks like one last question for Phoebe asking, what draws you to medical illustration exactly?
Well, I did comics since I was like 12. And they were always done in secret. It was always about things that were bothering me that I didn't want to tell anyone about. And so, but yet, like I had a grandmother who was a doctor, and I used to read her medical books, you know, even when I was very young. But at some point, I felt like I was so inside my head when I was doing comics. It was so much about like feelings or thoughts that I just really had this desire to know the physical. And I guess some people might start doing yoga or something, but to get in touch with their body. But I really wanted to know, you know, what it looks like on the inside. So, you know, we got to see autopsies and surgeries and everything else. And just to be able to visualize peristalsis and like the whole, you know, your organs moving all the time that you don't even feel. I mean, it gave me this, like, it just put these light bulbs going off in my head. And so it was, that's why I did it. It's not because I wanted to have a career in medical illustration, but I did for a while. It was more that I just wanted to know more. Yeah.
I love that. And Alex, I have some questions from folks asking, will there be signed copies available of Dog Biscuits?
Yes, I'm going to Elliott Bay Book Company in the next, I would assume in the next week, to sign a bunch of copies.
Excellent.
Yes. So order from Elliott Bay Book Company if you'd like a signed copy.
That's great. And we popped some links in the chat as well. And of course, both of our wonderful speakers' books are available at the library as well, and we posted links to the books there in the chat as well. Thank you both so much, and this was such a wonderful conversation. I wish we could keep going, but I know the folks have other commitments that they need to get to, but you can find, as we mentioned, both speakers' books at LA Bay Books or at the library. And I wanted to mention, I posted a link to the chat to the survey that we're asking folks to fill out. So if you want to take a minute, copy and paste that and fill that out afterward, that'd be great. We're so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you to our program partners, Elliott Bay Book Company, and our friends over at Fantagraphic Books. They're a local publisher that are internationally renowned, and so we're very proud that they're here. And actually, Eric Reynolds from Fantagraphics was part of the initial team that helped Seattle become a UNESCO City of Literature, so we're grateful to him for his work on that as well. Thanks to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to everybody who joined us tonight. We're so appreciative, and we will see you next time. Good night, everybody.
Thank you. Congratulations, Alex.
Thank you. Good night.
I love your book.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night, everybody.